This will be the first in a series of three videos I think I'm going to do on figuring out battery and alternator problems in your car. And in this one, to start with, I'll focus on the battery. Essentially, this is all about working out whether your problems stem from a dying or dead battery, or alternator, or maybe wiring and connections. So when you experience electrical problems out of the blue, a red flag symptom would be you just can't start the car. Maybe it turns over very slowly, or it doesn't crank at all, often with a loud clacking noise coming from the engine bay. Or a yellow flag, so to say, warning might be lights dimming at idle and then brightening when you increase the engine revs. The sort of thing that obviously indicates a lack of electrical power. And the challenge is working out where exactly the problem lies. And I'm going to keep this as simple as possible. I want to keep to the absolute basics here that are likely to cover most battery or alternator failures. So the very first thing to do is to check the battery over. First, of course, you'll need to find it. It's in the engine bays in most cars, although not all. Sometimes it's in the cabin, under a seat or somewhere. And in many modern cars, it will be covered up. This Golf has this fabric flexible enclosure for it, which you can just uncover at the top, while this Mondeo has a rigid black plastic cover. So in any case, find the battery and get access to the top of it. And once you've found it, give the terminals a visual inspection and make sure that they look something like these you see here. That's to say, nice and clean, with no corrosion, no white or colored powder looking stuff around them. If you can see any of that, it's a product of sulfate leaking out of the battery and reacting with the metal terminals. You can clean it off and try to keep going, but it's a bad sign for the battery as it means that the battery's seal has probably failed and possibly the battery has been overcharged previously. You can also check that the terminal connections are not loose. Just grab them and give them a wiggle. Make sure that you only touch one at a time, by the way, or you'll get a surprise. If they're movable by hand, just get the right tool and tighten them up. If you can't tighten them because a bolt or a nut's been damaged, then you'll have to replace whatever fitting needs it. Okay, so if you know you have a clean battery that's connected up properly, the next thing to do is stick a voltmeter on it and measure its charge. Now you should see something around 12.5 volts. If you know that the battery is flat, then you should recharge the battery before proceeding any further. Normally you could just take the car for a decent length drive, let the alternator top the battery up, but maybe you can't, in which case you can use just a cheap AC mains charger like this one. You plug it in, let it do its thing, and come back when you know that you have a actually fully charged battery. Now, by the way, if you have a flat battery and that's something that's unexpected, in other words, you haven't been, you know, noticing slowly worsening symptoms over time, then that might suggest that the alternator is at fault, but more testing would be required. So the general rule of thumb here is if you're having to jumpstart the car, and it then runs okay, but subsequently won't ever restart on its own, it's probably the battery at fault. On the other hand, if the car ever dies while you're driving it, and the battery is then ending up flat, then you should look to the alternator. One of the quickest checks that you can do is to look at the battery's inbuilt hydrometer. Most recent batteries have them as a little transparent lens, which will show a color when you look directly at it, usually red for dead and then green for charged. This inbuilt thing only lives in one out of the six cells, so it's not as good as a discrete hydrometer as a tool, which you would use to test all six cells. But most modern batteries are sealed, which means that you can't open them up to test them with a hydrometer anyway. So on to checking the battery further. Now, whether the battery was most recently charged from the alternator or mains power, you need to remove from it what's called surface charge, which is this chemistry that gives it a sort of fake voltage reading. You can do that by letting the battery sit for a long time, like up to a day. But if you don't have the time, then what you can do is just turn on the car's headlights and let them run for about 5 minutes or so. And then you'll be in a good place to use that voltmeter. You should be looking at a range of about 12.4 to 12.6 volts. Anything more than that and the battery is overcharged, which would, by the way, point to the alternator as a problem. And anything less than that and the battery is either not being charged, which again suggests the alternator, or it's unable to accept a charge. So in the negative case at this point, you would want to move on to testing the alternator. But if it looks okay, we want to try a load test on the battery. Now, you can get dedicated load testers, and they would be the easiest option here. They're not expensive. They run from about $20 up. Or you might even be able to borrow one from a local shop, especially any shop that's keen to sell you a new battery. However, if you're stuck without one, you have a few options. The best is if you have a multimeter which has a min/max function. And what you would do is hook it up to the battery and record the voltage during an engine start, and then look at the minimum voltage captured. Now, this multimeter that's shown here does not have that function, and its measurement rate just is not fast enough to be useful. So this lowest reading that you see here is not accurate. But if you had one, you would look for a minimum voltage during engine crank of 9.6 volts. Above that, the battery is capable of providing the cold cranking amps required by the car starter motor, which is really the crucial test for any car battery. Below that, and you're looking at trouble. In fact, if the voltage does dip below this, you might end up with error codes being set in the car's ECU by various modules complaining of undervoltage conditions. Now, if you don't have a min-max function on your multimeter, but if you do have a scan tool of some kind, an OBD tool, even a cheap one, you can try to do a sort of poor man's version of this test. Now, this will depend on the sampling speed of the tool, but if it's not complete rubbish, it should do a better job than the multimeters that you're seeing here. So this is a $20 Bluetooth module, and what you want to do is find the voltage as reported by the car's ECU. Now, this won't be as accurate as the voltmeter measurement straight across the battery terminals, but it is close enough to work with. And then measure only that in your tool, so as to dedicate all of the available bandwidth to that one data point. Put it in a graph form, maybe, or whatever will allow you to see the minimum. And then start the car and watch what the minimum of the dip is. Again, it should stay above 9.6 volts, unless it's freezing cold, by the way, in which case it may go a little lower. Although, again, the voltage at the module reporting it is usually a tiny bit lower than at the battery, so you do need to allow for a little error. Here you can see on the Golf, the dip touches the line at about 9.6 volts, so that's fine. But on the Ford, the result here, it's lower. I can scroll this recording back until I find it. And this one has gone down as far as 9.3 volts. Now, as I said, the voltage at the battery will be at a little bit higher. So we can guess at the corrective factor by just comparing the rest voltage from both methods like this, and then adding the difference to the previous measurement. In this case, adding the 60 millivolts to 9.3 volts to get 9.36 volts. Even if we call it 9.4, that's indicative of maybe a less than prime condition battery. So this could be a warning sign, even though this battery is still starting this car fine for the most part. Finally, if you can't manage any of that transient measurement to look at the 9.6 figure, what you can do is try dead cranking the engine. And of course, if your engine's not starting, then you would have no choice but to dead crank it. So that might be a moot point for you. But here in my case, I'm just removing the fuel pump relay so that the engine won't be able to run for lack of fuel. And with the voltmeter hooked up, I'm just cranking the engine for a while. 15 seconds is the period usually recommended. And what you want to see is the voltage over that period staying above 10 volts. And the difference here, why I'm not saying 9.6, is that the 9.6 volts relates to the practically instantaneous energizing of the starter motor, whereas here we're looking at the constant current draw over a relatively long period of time. And so if the voltage does stay up during these tests, but your engine still won't start, then you've ruled out the battery. You know that you then have a mechanical problem, something to do with the starter motor or crank sensors or something like that. Now, on the other hand, at this stage, you may have now identified a failed battery, in which case you can go on to replace it. Or, more likely, you may still need to check the alternator to eliminate one or the other. So that will be in the next video.